Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to Theodora Gazia for my invitation, and I'm very excited to stay after 2 years in New York in person. This is my disclosure. This is the evolution after the first balloon angioplasty of the PCI. And in 2010, like a dream, appeared the bioresorbable scaffold. And as Dr. Wasserman showed us several minutes ago, according with the luminal area modification, the attracting concept behind the BRS was to restore vessel integrity, to restore vasomotor reactivity and endothelial function, and the complete reabsorption that it was the real dream. But several studies arose some concern. The registry, Ghost European Registry, showed these very bad results at 6 months, 2% of target vessel MI, but more than this, 4% of TVR, 2.5 of TLR, and the stent thrombosis 2.1. And after this, in the same year, 2017, there was a meta-analysis about the ABSORB 3,261 patient in ABSORB versus everolimus eluting stent, and it showed us that it was a terrible result in terms of death, myocardial infarction, or revascularization. The authors tried to explain and stated that as these devices are less forgiving compared to DES, optimization of the final result and appropriate antithrombotic therapy maybe could be essential when scaffolds are implanted in complex lesions. And for this reason, they hypothesized some device-related mechanism of this failure, the thicker struts, the under-expansion, and the dismantling. And for this reason, they hypothesized a particular technique that it was so-called PSP in terms of predilatation, optimal sizing, and the post-dilatation of the stent. But the question is, bioresorbable stents, is the game over? First of all, we have to know that except the three phantom magmaris and this stent IBS, all the bioresorbable scaffold are made with a PLLA technical features. And this is very interesting, the summary of the polymeric BRS under investigation. You can see that between the most used stent, BRS, ABSORB, Mirage, and Phantom, all they discontinued or stopped the trial. Just two of those stents, the Dissolve and Magmaris, continued the trial and are again under investigation. Nevertheless, there is some reemergence. I think that this was the nail in the coffin of the ABSORB. The AIDA trial compared the ABSORB BVS with X-Science, and you can see even in this case very bad results of the ABSORBs in terms of TLR, 10.1% at 5 years, and the device thrombosis related 4.1%. But this trial gave us some interesting lessons. The first one, you can see the landmark analysis from clinical outcomes between 3 and 5 years. You can see that between 3 and 4 years, the device thrombosis related was not significantly different, but it was different just the TVR and TLR. And between 4 and 5 years, every of these result, it was not different between BVS and X-Science. And you can see the incidence of device thrombosis up to 5 years of follow-up. You can see that it's much more between the 24 hours and 30 days, up to 1 year, between 1 and 2 years. It starts to decrease between 2 and 3 years, and between 4 and 5 years, it was similar. The same effect of DAPT on events and scaffold thrombosis. You can see that overall, between 0 and 5 years, patient on DAPT, a patient off DAPT, it was the difference in favor of patient of DAPT. But this difference If you make the landmark analysis between 0 and 1 years, you can see the patients on DAP had a scaffold thrombosis of 70% versus 29%. But if you take after 1 year up to 5 years, you can see it's just 4.8 on DAP as events compared with 81% of patients of DAP. And the same thing for the scaffold thrombosis and non-scaffold thrombosis. You can see that overall 13 were on DAP, scaffold thrombosis and no scaffold thrombosis, but you can see that between 1 and 5 years, just one it was on DAP between the patient with scaffold thrombosis. Thus, this analysis was very interesting because, in my opinion, hypothesizes the reduction of this excessive risk maybe by prolonging DAP after VS implantation. This is another very utilized stent, the phantom stent, that it was not in PLLA, but its properties was the thyrocore that has some benefit respect to PLLA. And you can see this was presented last year at TCT by Matthias Lutz, the phantom 2 trial with not bad result at 60 months, just 5.4% of TLF. But even in this case, you can see that there were no new events between 36 and 48 months. You can see 0, 0.4, 0, and 0.8. And we move to Biosulfur registry, another very used, the Magmari scaffold that it was made by Magnesium. You can see the backbone, it was reabsorbed at 12 months, and the biolutin coating, it was reabsorbed at 24 months. This was presented by Stefan Veraje last year, it was published on CCI. You can see the stent thrombosis, it was quite good. And this was the sub-study of the Magmaris, the MAG-STEMI. You can see the overall, the all patient with ST elevation myocardial infarction. It was the comparison between Magmaris and sirolimus eluting stent. You can see that a 3-year follow-up, the device-oriented composite endpoint, it was more in, was increasing in BRS. The target lesion revascularization, it was more, and of course, the DAP prescription, it was more. But if you make a landmark analysis, even in this study, from 0 to 1 year, you have a more event according with device-oriented composite endpoint and TLR, but if you make the landmark analysis between 1 and 3 years, you don't have any difference between the two stents. Thus, the author stated that maybe the BRS was associated with a higher rate of a TLR clustered within the first year of follow-up. The Italian Society of Cardiology stated that some recommendation that it was like similar to the PSP technique, the 4P strategy that focused the attention on the patient selection, the proper sizing, the pre-dilatation, and the post-dilatation. And in this study, they stated that extension of DAP for 36 months as per the guidelines does not seem necessary for patients undergoing Magmaris implantation. This is just for Magmaris. Since the resorption process is already complete after 12 months, as opposite, that is very important to say the difference in the future, to PLLA scaffold like absorb, which require more than 36 and 48 months of resorption.
Professor Sardella, we have to summarize now.
Yes, okay. This is the last study, the aptitude scaffold that is the second generation that showed very good result in terms of late lumen loss. This is my my conclusion. The BRS in a short time have become the great revolution in this field, but with the same speed they fell down in the expectations of interventional cardiologists. Even though some companies who invested in this technology went bankrupt, but others are still investing in this field. Some lessons, an appropriate patient selection. The new generation BRS may be improved mechanical properties of this device has been shown that the difference in outcome with BRS as compared to everolimus-lutis 10 does no longer exist 3-4 years after BRS implantation. And finally, maybe an appropriate and BRS patient's fit duration of the DAPT is a crucial point to improve outcomes. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. That's an interesting and hopeful presentation.